Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, those who are with us right here in the College Heights Seventh Adventist Church, and those who are with us in the comforts of their home, viewing us via live stream. This is the 48th year that the Choral Union, under the direction of Dr. Wendelin Pajitka Monroe, have presented a Christmas program in this building. As I look back over the years, I remember that until about 10 or so years ago, our guests had to come early to ensure getting a seat, as it often became standing room only for our Friday night performance. Then, with the availability of live stream and, of course, the pandemic, our in-person numbers have dropped. But overall, our viewer numbers have increased. In other words, we are thrilled that our Christmas programs still have such an impact on you and that you are finding the gift of choral music to be an essential part of your holiday season. With social media so prevalent in our lives, we know that it would be impossible to ask you to keep your phones in your pockets or in your purses, but we will ask you to make sure that your notifications and ringtone are muted so that we don't get interrupted mid-song by an unfamiliar tune. We also invite you, while you're thinking about it, to follow us on our Instagram account, Burman University Choral Union. Again, Burman University Choral Union, all one squished together word. We have a wonderful program for you here tonight, from familiar carols, a tear-jerking story, to a Baroque work featuring the university orchestra. There will be something for everyone. And speaking of familiar carols, you're going to be invited to sing along with us a couple of times. You can see the songs listed in your programs, or if it's too dark to see when the time comes to sing, you will see it projected on the screen at the front of the church. Please stand and join us in the songs during those times. We'll be thrilled to hear your voices. And now, with the sound of the tambourine, let the music begin.
Good evening, church. 47 years ago, the Choral Union had chosen the Bible text, Romans 15, verse 6, to be our representing verse, which reads, "So that with one mind and one voice, you may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ." The choir has chosen this text as it represents our primary goal as a choir, which is to be unified in our voices and in our minds, proclaiming and glorifying our Savior, Jesus. As the choir presents these songs this evening, we ask and invite all of you as well to be united in one voice and one mind as we praise Jesus' holy name. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, O Lord, as we gather in celebration this evening, we come before you with grateful hearts, and for the warm season of Thanksgiving and of Christmas. This evening, we would like to acknowledge you, O Lord, as our Savior and your birth and your crucifixion, which is the ultimate reason of us meeting this evening. We thank you for the dedicated hearts of our musicians, our choir director, and us, the members of the choir. May our voices be united in song. May we do nothing this evening but praise your holy name. In the name of your Son and our Savior, Jesus. Amen.
Thank you. When Augustus Caesar was ruler of many kings, and Herod reigned in Jerusalem, far to the east, there lived a man named Artaban.
He was one of the Magi, those men of wisdom who searched for the stars, for signs of truth and light. Now, Araban and his three friends from the east had been studying the ancient words of the prophet.
There shall come a star out of Jacob, and a scepter shall arise out of Israel. My friends, the stars have shown us that time is at hand. We must make ready for our journey. In 10 days' time, we shall meet and travel to Jerusalem to see and worship the one who shall be born King of Israel.
Come on.
And so, the friends parted. Artaban sold his house and all his possessions and bought 3 jewels, a sapphire, a ruby, and a pearl, to carry with him as tribute to the promised one.
He saddled his fastest horse, set off along beneath the great mountain, across the flat plain where herds of horses tossed their heads and galloped away with the thunder of many hooves. Day after day he rode until the river led him to a great flat plain where he traveled until late in the night. And the horse needed rest, but it was still 3 hours' journey to the meeting place. Suddenly, Artaban's horse stopped and shuddered with fear. Artaban dismounted and approached a dark object lying within the shadows.
It is a man, but I fear he's already dead.
But just as Artaban turned to go, a long, faint sigh came from the man's lips. Artaban's heart leapt to his throat, not with fear, but with resentment at the possible delay.
How can I stay here and minister to this dying stranger? If I delay even an hour, I surely will not arrive by the appointed time. My companions will think I have abandoned my quest. Yet, if I leave him, this man will surely die. How can I deny him such a small act of mercy?
Araban carried the poor man to the foot of a tree nearby, where he labored for hours, cooling his brow, giving him sips of water, and healing medicines. At last, the man awoke and asked, "Who are you? And why have you brought back my life?"
"I am Artaban, one of the Magi. I am going to Jerusalem in search of the one who is king of the Jews and deliverer of all men. I cannot delay any longer, but I leave you food and medicine and shelter in the nearby village."
The man looked toward heaven and said, "Nothing have I to give to you, but I can tell you this. Our prophets have said that the Messiah should be born in Bethlehem of Judea. May the Lord bless you in your search."
"Oh, it is long past the appointed hour. But Artaban rode like the wind to reach the temple. He searched anxiously, but found no trace of his friends until finally he saw parchment under a small mound of rocks. It read, 'We waited past midnight and can delay no longer. We go to find the king. Follow us across the desert.'" Artaban covered his head in despair.
"How can I cross the desert with no food and an exhausted horse? I must sell my sapphire and buy a camel and supplies for my journey. Only God knows whether I shall lose sight of the king because I stopped to show mercy."
And so it passed that Artaban set out to cross the cruel and desolate desert. By day, the fierce heat pressed down upon him. By night, wolves howled in the distance. Yet Artaban moved steadily onward, like a lonely ship over the waves.
Load I bear in the world.
After many days, Araban arrived in Bethlehem, where he happened upon a small cottage. Entering, he found a young mother and her wee babe. She told him of the strangers from the east who had appeared 3 days before, bringing precious gifts to a man by the name of Joseph, his wife Mary, and their newborn son. But the traveler had disappeared just as suddenly as they had come. And then Joseph and his family fled to Egypt, for it was said there was danger in the air. Araban's heart sank as he listened to her words.
God of wisdom, you have not seen fit to reward my search so soon and so easily. The one whom I seek has gone before me, and now I must follow the king to Egypt.
Suddenly, there was wild confusion in the streets, and a desperate cry was heard. Soldiers! Herod's soldiers are killing the children! Artaban waved the terrified mother into the shadows and went quickly to stand in the doorway of the house. The soldiers hurried toward him, but Artaban refused to move.
I am all alone in this place. I am waiting to give this ruby to the captain who will leave me in peace.
Greedily, the soldier snatched the jewel, turned to face his men. March on! There are no children here. The house is empty.
God of truth, forgive me my sin. A lie I told to save the life of a child, and to a man I gave that which was meant for God. Shall I ever be worthy to see the face of the king?
And in the shadows, a mother silently wept for joy. The years flowed swiftly by. Artaban moved through the crowds in Egypt, seeking everywhere for traces of that family from Bethlehem. Traces so faint, they vanished as footprints on the river sand, glistening for a moment with moisture, and then disappearing. A rabbi, helping Artaban search the rolls for prophetic parchment, said, "Remember, my son, the Messiah is to be despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. The king you are seeking is not to be found in a palace or among the rich and powerful, but among the poor and lowly, the sorrowful and the oppressed."
Thank you.
And so it was that Artaban traveled from place to place. He visited the sick, the oppressed, and the afflicted in prisons. He saw the crowded wretchedness of the slave markets and the weary toil of the galley ships. In this crowded world of anguish, though, he found none to worship, he found many to help. He fed the hungry, clothed the naked, healed the sick, and comforted the captive. 33 years of his life passed, and still he searched, worn and weary, with hair as white as snow and eyes as dull as smoldering embers. He still looked for the king. Coming once again to Jerusalem, at the season of the Passover, the city was filled with strangers that had returned for the great feast. However, on this day, the sky was veiled with an ominous gloom. Currents of excitement seemed to flash through the visibly agitated crowd, as if it were the eve of a storm. Artaban joined the clattering throng moving along the streets to the city gate.
What's all the excitement about? Where are you going?
They answered, we're going to this place called Golgotha, where there's to be an execution. Have you not heard? Two famous robbers are to be crucified, and with them another called Jesus of Nazareth, who claims to be the Son of God.
How strange that I should hear these words after so many years. Can this be the one who is promised? Shall I find the king at last in the hands of his enemies? Perhaps if I get there on time, I can offer my pearl in a ransom before he dies.
The old man followed the multitude onward toward the city gate. Ahead, a troop of soldiers marched down the street, dragging a young girl. As Artaban paused to look at her, she suddenly broke free and threw herself at his feet. "Have pity on me," she cried. "Save me. My father was a merchant, but he's dead, and I'm seized for his debts. They're going to sell me to slavery. Please save me."
Stars are brightly shining. It is the night of the dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining, till he appeared and the soul felt its worth. A thrill rejoices, for yonder breaks the new and glorious morn. Fall on your knees, oh, hear the angels' voices. for the slave is our brother, and in his name all oppression shall cease. Sweet hymns of joy in grateful chorus raise, we let all within us praise his holy name.
Arabin trembled. Once again, he felt the old conflict in his soul. It was the conflict between the expectations of faith and the impulse of love.
Twice, the gifts had been snatched from his hand in service to humanity. This was the third trial, the final test. He took the pearl from his tunic. Never had it seemed so luminous, so radiant, so full of luster.
Here is your ransom, daughter. It is the last of my treasures, which I had kept for the king.
And while he spoke, the sky darkened, and shuddering tremors ran through the earth as if they were struggling with a mighty grief. The walls of the houses rocked back and forth. Stones were loosened and crashed to the street. The soldiers ran like drunken men, leaving Artaban and the young girl all alone. Suddenly, a heavy tile fell and struck Artaban on the temple. He lay breathless and pale, with his head resting on the young woman's shoulders. As she bent over him, there came a voice through the twilight, very small and still. It was like music sounding from a distance, in which the notes are clear, but the words lost. The girl turned to see who had spoken. but there's no one there. The old man seemed to hear. With the last of his strength, he said,
"Not so, my lord. For when did I see you hungry and give you food, or thirsty and give you drink? When did I see you a stranger and take you in, or naked and give you clothing? When did I see you sick or in prison and come to you? 33 years have I searched for you, but I have never seen your face or ministered to you, my king."
As he finished, the sweet voice came again, and again the young woman heard it, very faintly, far away. But now it seemed as though she understood the words. "Verily I say unto you, inasmuch as you have done it unto the least of these my people, you have done it unto me."
A calm radiance of wonder and joy illuminated the pale face of Araban. Just like the first ray of dawn on a snowy mountain peak, one long last breath escaped gently from his lips. His journey was ended. His treasures were accepted. The other wise men had found the king.
I recall reading recently, but now I do have to admit that as I get older, my concept of recently has become rather flexible. In reality, I don't recall if it was last Christmas season or several seasons ago, but in truth, it doesn't matter. The story goes that a young family was returning home from spending an early Christmas celebration with grandparents as they were leaving on a cruise. It had been a wonderful get-together, and the little boy of the family had certainly been spoiled by the presents he had received. On the way home, they stopped by a well-known cathedral, one of those that puts on a live nativity scene, to view the effort put into it and, of course, to see all the live animals. It is told that once the excitement of seeing all the animals and the exquisitely constructed props had died down, the little boy became transfixed as he stood before the manger, watching the little baby lie there along with the wise men and the shepherds. He suddenly broke away from his parents and ran back to the car, where, after shuffling around a bit, he soon returned holding his prized possession, a large transformer. Without a word, he ducked under the rope and walked to the manger, placing his transformer as close to the baby as he could. Returning to his parents, he said, "Let's go home." The local news station soon caught word of this selfless act, and before long, people were streaming to the nativity scene to drop off presents. It became one of the best Christmases for the poor children of that city. It sort of reminds me of the song, "The Little Drummer Boy," a boy who had nothing to give Jesus other than his talent of playing a drum. The real-life little boy had done the same. He had given his most important toy to the baby, the one he had talked about nonstop for the whole year. The Choral Union is grateful for what you have done for us in the past. In fact, we rely on your generosity to help us to share the love of Jesus through our music to others across this great land. This year, we are traveling through British Columbia and down the west coast of the U.S. Our costs for this tour are exceeding $80,000. Your Christmas gift to us this evening will help us cover part of that cost. We're not asking you to give of your all. We're not asking you even to give enough to prevent you from getting your looked-forward-to gift. We are asking you to give generously to the babe of Christmas so that we can spread his love to others. In your programs, you'll find envelopes that you can fill out and enclose your offerings in. And for those of you who maybe came unprepared this evening, and also for those of you who are sitting at home, in your programs and on the screen now, you will see a QR code. Scanning that code will take you to the Burman University giving page. Just click on the drop-down list and select the Choral Union and Chamber Singers option. And whether you choose to make a one-time donation or an ongoing donation, your gift will go to the choir to help us spread the good news through music and word. And for those of you who have trouble in accessing QR codes, you can go directly to burmanu.ca and click the red Give button at the top of the screen, and you'll get to the same place. We, of course, do appreciate each of your gifts, no matter how much or how you give them. As you can see on the back of your programs, we do recognize those of you who have given $50 or more to the Choral Union. In addition, for donations of $10 or more, we'll be happy to give you a tax-deductible receipt in return. We do ask that you prayerfully and generously give as the men of the choir come and collect your gifts. But before they do, let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, you have given us a wonderful gift in the form of your Son. We thank you that this is the season that we remember him. We also thank you that you have given us our voices that we can lift in praise to him and to share the word with others. Dear Lord, as we collect this offering this evening, we ask that you will inspire and rest heavily upon those who are giving. May their gift be done in thanks and in love to you. In Jesus' name, amen. To an unbeliever, it is incomprehensible that a young girl, probably only 13 or 14 years old, but certainly no more than the ripe old age of 16, could become pregnant by some mysterious means and deliver a baby who is God, who has always been, and who always will be. In fact, even to believers, it is a mystery of godliness that we must accept by faith. Antonio Vivaldi, the composer of Gloria, faced this mystery as he wrote this piece. Perhaps challenged while composing by the beliefs and the restrictions of the prominent church of the day, he has created a masterful work showcasing the entire plan of salvation. As you listen to this choral work, our hope is that it reminds you that Christmas is not just about the birth of a baby, even though the baby was God. Christmas is also about the Redeemer hanging on the cruel cross, bursting forth in conquest from the tomb, daily pleading the sacrifice of his blood in mercy for sinners, and the soon triumphal return to take us home to dwell with him for eternity. After all, isn't that the best Christmas present that we could get?
Gloriamus Dei, adoramus Dei, glorifica.
Glorifica.
Oh,
miserere, miserere nobis. Let's pray. Our Father who art in heaven, thank you, Lord, for it is because of you that we're here. You are the reason for this beautiful season, Lord. You've given us the gift that is above all gifts, and you have been manifested with all of your glory. Lord God, today we thank you for, through the music, reminding us of the eternal life that you've promised us through your Son, Jesus. I pray today that as we leave this place, that all the songs that were sung, the prayers that were made, the words that were shared, be engraved in our hearts and help us for the better. I pray that through this Christmas season, we remember why we celebrate this Christmas event. Help us to think of you and what you've done for us, and walk in hope and faith, for through you we have the gift of life. We love you, Lord. Bless each and every one of us that are here. And as we go back home, be with us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
On behalf of our director, Dr. Wendlin Pajetka Monroe, and our accompanist, Nicole Bartolet, I would like to thank you for spending your evening with us. It is the sincere desire of the choir that tonight you have found Jesus in the music and spoken word. Our title, The Wise Still Seek Him, is as appropriate today as it was in the story of the other wise men, and in the stories of billions of people who throughout the ages have sought and found the baby, the risen Savior, and the soon coming conquering Redeemer. As we look at the events happening all around the world, we can't help but realize that our time here is short. So whether it is tonight that you have made a decision to begin your journey in seeking the Savior, or whether you are a long, lifelong seeker, we pray that during the holiday season, you find him and in faith hold on to him, so that each one of us will be able to shout Gloria together when he returns very soon to take us home. Thank you and good night.